Today we are going to discuss about zeros, singularities of analytic function and residual theorems. And this part is actually in chapter 3 of complex analysis. So myself, Sanjay Vishwas, assistant professor of mathematics, department of applied science and humanities of Guru Nanak Institute of Technology. Here is my contact information. If you are facing any kind of problem regarding my online class or online course, you can contact me freely or send message in my mail ID sanjay.vishwas@gnit.ac.in. Before we start today's lecture, let's quickly recall in the last lecture. So in the last lecture, we have already discussed in chapter 2 the statement of Taylor series. After that we have talked about example of Taylor series. After that we have discussed about the Lorentz series and some related examples on Lorentz series. Let us move on the next slide. Today we are going to discuss about zeros, singularities of an analytic function. This is my 9th lecture on online courses, zeros and singularities of an analytic function. So here is the content of today's lecture. Now, first of all, we are begin with zeros of an analytic function. After that, we'll study on the singularities of an analytic function. Then some related example on singularities and the zeros of a analytic function we'll discuss. After that we'll talking about some definitions, essential singularities and poles of functions on the Argand plane, and some related theorem we'll discuss. And after that we'll talking about some examples on essential singularity and pole of a analytic functions. So first of all, we are going to define some related definitions of analytic functions. So we are begin with the definition of zeros. Okay, so here is the definition. The values of z, say z is equal to alpha, for which the analytic function f of z becomes zero, is said to be a zero of the function. Okay, so at that point z is equal to alpha, where the function f of z, and f of z is analytic function, and it becomes zero. That means if the function is a fractional function, so where the denominator and numerator parts are exist, then if the denominator part and it will be zero, then the function and it should be zero. So from this we will get the value of z, and this value is called a zeros of a function. Okay, in particular. So after that we are going to talk about the order of a zero. So in this regard, if the function f of z is analytic in the domain D, okay, and D be a domain on the Argand plane, and alpha is any point of D, then we can expand f of x as a Taylor series about the point z is equal to alpha. I have already mentioned in the last class how to expand the Taylor series about the point z is equal to alpha. This is the expansion of Taylor series f of z is equal to summation over n is equal to 0 to infinity n into z minus alpha whole to the power n. So from this, if a0 is equal to a1 is equal to a2 and up to an minus m minus 1 is equal to 0, but am is equal is not equal to 0, then f of z is said to have a order m at z is equal to alpha. That means from this it is clear that if the function f of z about the point z is equal to alpha is 0, first derivative of f of z, second derivative of f of z, and up to the m minus 1th derivative at the point z is equal to alpha is 0, but f to the power m of alpha, that means the nth order differentiation, and it should be not equals to 0, then f of j is said to have a 0 of order m at z is equal to alpha. So after that we are going to discuss about the simple zero of an analytic function f of z. In this regard, here the order of zero is 1 actually. So if m is equal to 1, that is a zero of order 1 is said to be a simple zero. After that we are going to find some related examples on zeros, order of a zeros and simple zeros. So let us move on the next slide. So there are some examples on zeros and simple zeros or order of a zeros. So here is the example. The zeros are isolated. Okay, that is the function f of z is equal to z minus 2 by z square sine of 1 by z minus 1 has 0 at z is equal to 2. That means at the point z is equal to 2, this function is should be 0. That is, z is equal to 2 is a zeros of a function, and this 0 is called a simple 0. Okay, that is the order of a 0 is equal to 1. Also, from the second part, that means this one, sine of 1 by z minus 1. Okay. If this is also the numerator part of this function, and z square is the denominator part, okay. If z square is equal to 0, then from this we cannot find the zeros of a function, and this is called actually the pole of a function, okay. And the pole singularities we will discuss in the next slide. Now we are talking about only the zeros of function. So if the second part of this function, that means sine of 1 by z minus 1 is equals to 0, and from this we will get the value of 1 by z minus 1, and it will be in where n is equal to plus minus 1, plus minus 2 and up to infinity. So from this we will get the value of z, and it will be z is equal to 1 plus 1 by n pi, where n is equal to plus minus 1, plus minus 2 and up to infinity. So these are all the zeros of a function f of z, and these zeros are the simple zeros. Okay, so if we put n is equal to 1, we will get the zero value of z, and at that point we will find the value of f of z, and it should be 0. Okay, similarly when we put n is equal to minus 1, we will get the value of z, and it will be 1 minus 1 by pi, and at that point the functional value, that is f of z, is equal to 0. That is, these values, that is 1 plus 1 by n pi, for n is equal to plus minus 1, plus minus 2, are all the simple zeros of the function f of z. After that we are talking about one more example on zeros and order of a zeros. So here the function f of z is equal to sine square z. So at the point z is equal to 0, the sine square 0 is equal to, you know, this is the value, is equal to 0. Now we differentiate this equation with respect to z, we will get 2 into sine z into derivative of sine z, and it will be cos z. So 2 sine z cos z, if that z is equal to, okay. Similarly, if we put z is equal to 0, and from this we will get the value of f of z, f dash z, and it will be also 0. But the second order differentiation, and it will gives at the point z is equal to 0 is equal to 2, and you know 2 is not equal to 0. So therefore the functional value at the point z is equal to 0 is 0. First order derivative, it is also 0, but the second order differentiation about the point z is equal to 0, and it should be 2 and is not equal to 0. Therefore from the definition of zeros of order m, we have seen that here m is equal to 2. Therefore, at z is equal to 0, and z is equal to 0 is a zeros of order 2 of the analytic function f of z is equal to sine square z. Okay, so that is the zeros of an analytic function are isolated singularities. Okay. First of all, we are going to define the singularities of a function. Okay. So here is the definition of singularities. If the function f of z is not analytic at the point z is equal to alpha, then alpha is called the singularities or singular point of f of z. Okay, so for example, say f of z is equal to 1 by z minus 1. Okay, so this function is not analytic at the point z is equal to 1. So at the point z is equal to 1, this function is not analytic, that is, this function is undefined. Therefore, z is equal to 1 is a singular point or singularities of the function f of z. And except at z is equal to 1, this function is analytic. So, z is equal to 1 is called a singular point. For that, we are going to talk about some more definitions of singularities. So, here are the definitions: isolated and non-isolated singularities. So, what is the isolated singularities? If alpha is a singular point or singularities of f of z, and f of z is analytic at each point in a neighborhood of z is equal to alpha, then it is called a isolated singularities of f of z. Otherwise, it is called non-isolated. So, that means around the point z is equal to alpha, and you know there are infinite number of points in a neighborhood of z is equal to alpha, and each point except z is equal to alpha, the function f of z is analytic, then and from this we'll say z is equal to alpha is a isolated singularity. We consider some examples on isolated and non-isolated singularities. So let the function f of z is equal to 1 by z minus 1. So this function is analytic everywhere except at z is equal to 1. So if we take a circle or a neighborhood around the point z is equal to 1, so you know there are infinite number of points around the point z is equal to 1, and each of these points the function f of z is analytic. Okay, so therefore z is equal to 1 is called a isolated singularities for the function f of z is equal to 1 by z minus 1. Now we will take one more example on isolated singularities. So here is the example. So f z is equal to z square plus 5 by z into z minus 3 into z square plus 1. So this function is analytic except at the point z is equal to 0, z is equal to 3 and z is equal to plus minus r. That means if we put the denominator part is 0, and from this we will get z is equal to 0, z minus 3 is equal to 0, as well as z square plus 1 is equal to 0. So from the first factor we will get z is equal to 0. So z is equal to 0 is called a isolated singularities, as well as if we put z minus 3 is equal to 0, and from this we will get z is equal to 3. Therefore, z is equal to 3 is also the isolated singularities, and z square plus 1 is equal to 0. From this, we will get z is equal to plus minus r, and at the point z is equal to plus I, and as well as at the point z is equal to minus I, this function are not analytic. That is, this point is called the isolated singularities. Okay. Now we are moving for the next problem, and this problem is basically on the non-isolated singularities. Okay, here is the example: f of z is equal to 1 by tan pi by z. So you know tan pi by z is equal to sine pi by z by cos pi by z. So this equation is reduced to cos pi by z by sine pi by z. Okay, and you know the sine pi by z, the denominator part is actually, if the denominator part is 0, then from this we will get the singularities or singular point of the function f of z, where the function is not analytic. And from this it has infinite number of isolated singularities which lie on the real axis from z is equal to minus 1 to that is equal to plus 1. Okay. And these isolated singularities are given by when we put sin phi by z is equal to 0, and from this it will give z is equal to plus minus 1 by n. Okay, that is when n is equal to 1, 2, 3 and up to infinity. So therefore, z is equal to plus minus 1 by n are the singular points or the singularities of the function f of z is equal to 1 by 10 pi by z. The origin z is equal to 0, okay, and around the point z is equal to 0 there are infinite number of points. So you know 1 by n is the point is lies very near to the point z is equal to 0. That means in a neighborhood of z is equal to 0 there are infinite number of points like plus minus 1 by n, and you know has non-isolated singularities about the point z is equal to 0. So in the neighborhood of z is equal to 0 there are infinite number of other singularities for the function f of z. Okay, let us move on the next slide. So in this section we are going to talk about poles and real singularities of an analytic functions. Before we start removable singularities and pole, we are going to talk about the Lorentz series or Lorentz theorem, and I have already mentioned in the previous class actually. Okay, so what is the principal part of analytic functions, and this part will taken from the Lorentz series actually. So you know what is the Lorentz series. So let alpha be an isolated singularities of an analytic function f of z in a domain D. Now we draw a circle C1 with center at the point z is equal to alpha. Okay, and alpha is the center of the point of the circle C1, and radius of this circle as small as possible. That means the center at the point z is equal to alpha and this circle is very small, okay, but the radius is as small as possible. And we'll take another circle and it will be say C2, okay, and this circle is very large and concentric with the circle C1. That is, the center of the circle C1 as well as C2 are same, okay, and C1 is lies only within C. So if any radius lying only within the domain D, then f of z is analytic within the annular region of two concentric circle C1 and C2. So that means in between C1 and C2, so you know C1 and C2 are two concentric circle with the same center, therefore in between C1 and C2 there is a region, okay, and this region is called a annular region between C1 and C2. Hence by Lorentz theorem we have f of z is equal to summation n is equal to 0 to infinity n into z minus alpha whole to the power n plus summation over n is equal to 1 to infinity bn into z minus alpha whole to the power minus n. And the second term on the right hand side of this Lorentz theorem or Lorentz series is called the principal part of the function f of z about the point z is equal to alpha. That means the negative power of z minus alpha are called the principal part of the function f of z, where f of z can be expressed as a series function, and this series is called a Lorentz series. Let us move on the next slide. So from the principal part of the Lorentz series we will get the pole as well as essential singularities, and if the principal part is 0, or the all the terms of a principal part are 0, and from this we will get the removable singularities. So first of all we will talking about the definition of a pole. So if the principal part of f of z contain only the finite number of terms say m, then the singularity z is equal to alpha is called the pole of order n. So in a Lorentz series you know there are infinite number of terms, So if the principal part will contain only the finite number of terms, say m, so this is the Lorentz series, f of z is equal to summation over n is equal to 0 to infinity n into z minus alpha whole to the power n plus b1 by z minus alpha plus b2 by z minus alpha whole square and up to bm by z minus alpha whole to the power n. So principal part will contain the only the m number of terms. So this term is a finite term. So therefore, from Lorentz series, the highest power of z minus 1 is finite, z minus alpha is finite, and the finite highest power is actually n, and this is called the order of a pole. And in this regard, the order of a pole is m. And there is a theorem on pole and zeros. So if the function f of z is analytic, has a pole of order m at z is equal to alpha, then 1 by f of z, that means the reciprocal of f of z, has a zero of order m at z is equal to alpha. And conversely, if f of z has a zero at z is equal to alpha, and from this we will get the pole of the function 1 by f of z, okay, at the point z is equal to alpha, and the order of 1 by f of z, that means order of a pole of the function 1 by f of z is m. This is the theorem, and from this theorem we get pole from the zeros of a function, and as well as we will find the zeros of a function from the pole of an analytic function. So after that we are going to discuss about the removable singularities, and it is also obtained from the Lorentz series. Okay, so if all the terms of the principal part of Lorentz series are zero, that means f of z is zero, the principal part of f of z is zero at z is equal to alpha, and that means the principal part consists of no terms, then alpha is called the removable singularities. Okay, so we remove these singularities by defining the function f of z at z is equal to alpha, and in such a way that it becomes analytic at z is equal to alpha. For example, the function f of z is equal to, here is the example, f of z is equal to sin z minus 1 by z minus 1. So, has a removable singularities at z is equal to 1. Because sin of z minus 1 by z minus 1, and it can be expressed as a Lorentz series, okay, expansion. So, first of all, the sin of 1 by z is equals, you know, sin of 1 z minus 1 is a series function, and it will be the first term is z minus 1. Second term is z minus 1 whole square by 3 factorial, and up to there are n number of terms, and after divided by z minus 1, and it will gives 1 minus z minus 1 whole square by 3 factorial plus z minus 1 whole to the power 4 by 5 factorial and up to infinity. So this term, so and from this there are positive power of z minus 1, and from this term will contain no negative power of z minus 1. Therefore, sin z minus 1 by z minus 1 is a removable singularity at z is equal to 1. And there is a note on removable singularities. If f of z has a removable singularity at z is equal to alpha, then limit z tends to alpha, z minus alpha into f of z is equal to 0. Okay, this is actually the removable singularities, but if we multiply by z minus 1 on the right hand side, we will get the value at z is equal to 1 is 0. Okay, so this is the actually the theorem on notes on removable singularities. After that, we are going to talk about the essential singularities of an analytic function f of z. So, and an essential singularity is also found from the Lorentz series expansion. So in this regard, here the function f of z, that is the principal part of f of z, will contain an infinite number of terms. Then the singularity z is equal to alpha is called the essential singularities. That means the principal part, and you know, in a principal part there are infinite number of terms, and the power of z minus alpha are all negatives. So from this we are going to take an example on essential singularities. So here is the example. So f of z, say e to the power 1 by z. So after expanding this function, we will get the series. So first term is 1, second term 1 by z, third one 1 by 2 factorial into z square, plus 1 by 3 factorial into z to the power 3, and up to infinity. So there are infinite number of terms. So e to the power 1 by z is a series function and contain an infinite number of terms in negative power of z. Therefore, z is equal to 0 is called an essential singularities. And from essential singularities, you know, there are two types of singularities. First one is isolated essential singularities, and second one is non-isolated singularities, essential singularities. First of all, we will go for the isolated essential singularities. So this is the isolated essential singularities. If there are infinite number of terms in a principal part of Lorentz series at z is equal to alpha, then alpha is called the isolated essential singularities. And this is actually the similar as the definition of a essential singularities. And I have already discussed some examples on isolated essential singularities, e to the power 1 by z. Okay. So similarly, I will take one more example on essential singularities, isolated sine 1 by z. So sine of 1 by z has isolated essential singularities at z is equal to 0. So you know, sine of 1 by z is a series function, and if apply the Taylor series, and from this we will get an infinite number of terms. So the first term is 1 by z, second term is 1 by 3 factorial, okay, 1 by into 1 by z to the power 3, plus 1 by 5 factorial into 1 by z to the power 5. So that is, sine 1 by z has infinite number of negative power of z, that is z is equal to 0 is called a isolated essential singularities for the function sine 1 by z. So there is a theorem on isolated essential singularities. The limit point of the zeros of a function f of z is an isolated essential singularities. Now we are looking for the definition of a non-isolated essential singularities. So the limit point of the sequence of pole of the function f of z is said to be the non-isolated essential singularities. So for example, we consider the function tan 1 by z. So you know, the tan 1 by z, after simplifying, we'll get it tan 1 by z by cos 1 by z. Okay, so if we put cos 1 by z is equal to 0, and from this we'll get the pole of a function. Okay, and from this we will get the value of z, and it will be 2 by n pi for n is equal to plus minus 1, plus minus 3, plus minus 5, and up to infinity. And therefore, the limit point of the sequence of pole is z is equal to 0. So at n tends to infinity, and from this we will get the value of z, and it will be 0. So which is the, that means the z is equal to 0 is called the non-isolated essential singularities. So there is a theorem on non-isolated essential singularities. The limit point of the set of all poles of the function f of z is a non-isolated essential singularities. Let's move on the next slide. So in this slide, we are going to talk about the some examples on zero singularities analytic functions. First of all, we'll take example 1. We'll find out the zeros and discuss the nature of the roots of the function f of z is equal to z minus 2 by z square into sine 1 by z minus 1. So you know, if the denominator part of the of any functions is equals to 0, then from this we'll get the whole of a function, and the numerator part of any functions f of z is 0, and from this we'll get the zeros of the functions, and from this we after this we'll get the nature of the roots. Okay, so let's start with the solution of a function f of z is equal to z minus 2 by z is equal to sine 1 by z minus 1. So pole of a function are given by putting the denominator is 0, and here z square is the denominator of this function, and from this we will get z is equal to 0. So z is equal to 0 is a pole of order 2, and as well as 0 can be found from the from this function when the numerator part is 0. So that means z minus 2 into sine 1 by z minus 1, and it should be 0. So there are two factors, and if the two factors is 0, so individually the factors are all 0. So from this we will get z minus 2 is equal to 0, as well as sine of 1 by z minus 1 is equal to 0. So now when z minus 2 is equal to 0, and from this we will get z is equal to 2, and when sine of 1 by z minus 1 is equal to 0, and it will give 1 by z minus 1 is equal to n pi, and you know n is equal to 1 plus minus 1 plus minus 2 plus minus 3 and up to infinity, and from this we will get the value of z, and z is equal to 1 plus 1 by n pi. So the all the zeros of the function f of z are given by z is equal to 2 and z is equal to 1 plus minus n pi, where n is equal to plus minus 1 plus minus 2 and up to infinity. Okay, and the limit point of the zeros, and you know there is a theorem on the isolated essential singularity and non-isolated essential singularities. I have already mentioned in the last slide. The limit point of the zeros are given by z is equal to 1 plus minus 1 by n pi, where n is equal to plus minus 1 plus minus 1 2 up to infinity. Now move on the next example. So here is the example. Find the Lorentz series about the indicated singularities for the function f of z is equal to e to the power z square by z to the power 3 at z is equal to 0. Let's solve the given problems. So here f of z is equal to e to the power z square by z to the power 3. So you know e to the power z square is the exponential function, and this is actually the series function. So the first term of e to the power z square is 1, second term is z square, third term is z square whole square by 2 factorial, then z square whole to the power 3 by 3 factorial and up to infinity. Okay, so that is 1 plus z square plus z to the power 4 by 2 factorial plus z to the power 6 by 3 factorial and up to infinity into 1 by z to the power 3. So from this we will get the series function of f of z, and it will be the first term is 1 by z to the power 3, second term is 1 by z, and third one is z by 2 factorial, and after that we will get z to the power 3 by 3 factorial and up to infinity. Therefore the highest power of 1 by z in the Lorentz, and this is actually the Lorentz series, and it will obtain from e to the power z square by z to the power 3, and the negative power of z, that means the highest power of 1 by z in the Lorentz series, is actually 3, or the negative power of z of this Lorentz series is 3. So z is equal to 0 is the pole of order 3. After that we are going to talk about some more example on zeros and singularities. That is the example, this is number 3, that is third example on zeros and singularities. So find the singularities of the following functions and determine their natures. The first problem is 1 by sin z minus cos z. After that we are going to discuss the singularities and nature of the singularities for the function sec 1 by z, and after that we will go for 1 minus e to the power z by 1 plus e to the power z. And you know, I have already discussed, if the denominator part of any function is 0, then from this we will get the pole of a function. And if the numerator part of any function will be 0, and from this we will get the zeros of a function, okay. And limit point of the 0 is called a isolated essential singularity, and limit point of pole is called a non-isolated essential singularity. So these two are the nature of the singularities, okay. So let's start with the example 1. So if the denominator part of this function is 0, so that means sin z minus cos z is equal to 0, and from this we will get tan of z is equal to 0. So therefore z is equal to n pi plus pi by 4 divided n is equal to 0, 1, 2, 3 up to infinity. So the all the poles of this, these are all the pole of the function 1 by sin z minus cos z, and these pole are all simple pole. So after that we are going to talk about the second example on the given question. So here is the problem. So sec 1 by z, okay. So you know the reciprocal of sec 1 by z is equal to cos 1 by z, okay. That means sec 1 by z is equal to 1 by cos 1 by z. And a similar thing will happen in that problem. So now we put cos 1 by z is equal to 0, and from this we will get the pole of a function, okay. And you know cos 1 by z is equal to 0, and from this we will get 1 by z is equal to n pi plus pi by 2. That means z is equal to 1 by n pi plus pi by 2, where n is equal to 0, plus minus 1, plus minus 2, and up to infinity. So these are all the pole of a function, and from this we'll get the limiting value of this pole, okay. So obviously the limit point of the pole is 0. If we put n is equal to infinity on this function, and we'll get the value of z, and it will be 0. So 1 by infinity is equal to 0, you know. So hence z is equal to 0 is a non-isolated essential singularity of a function sec, it is sec 1 by z. And you know I have already discussed in isolated and non-isolated singularities. So you know there are some theorem on isolated and non-isolated singularities. If the limit point of pole is called a non-isolated singularities, and limit point of 0 is an isolated singularity. So in this regard the limit point of a pole is actually 0. So therefore z is equal to 0 is a non-isolated essential singularity. So after that we are talking about the third example, and you know this is the third example, 1 minus e to the power z by 1 plus e to the power z. So similar thing will happen in that in this problem. So if the denominator part will be 0, and from this we will get z is equal to 2n plus 1 into 5, okay. So after the simplifying we will get this one. So had n is equal to 0, plus minus 1, plus minus 2. So obviously if we put n tends to infinity, from this we will get the value of z, and it will be also infinity, okay. So therefore the limit point of this pole is infinity. So therefore z is equal to infinity is the non-isolated, this is non-isolated essential singularities. Understood? After that we are going to talk the last example on today's lecture. Here is the example. Find the Lorentz series about the indicated singularities of the following function, and also determine the nature of the roots. E to the power z by z minus 1 whole to the power 3 at z is equal to 1. So let us consider the function f of z is equal to e to the power z by z minus 1 whole to the power 3. Okay, so now we put z minus 1 is equal to u, and from this function, and we will get e to the power 1 plus u by e to the power 3. So you know z minus 1 is equal to u, so then from this we will get z is equal to 1 plus u. So now we, and e to the power 1 plus u is equal to e to the power u into e to the power 1, okay. So e to the power u is a exponential function, and you know there are infinite number of terms in an exponential function. If we apply the Taylor series or Lorentz series, we will get 1 plus u plus u square by 2 factorial plus u cube by 3 factorial and up to infinity into e by e to the power u to the power 3. Now divided by u to the power 3 on this series function, and we will get e into 1 by e to the power 3 plus 1 u square plus 1 by 2 factorial, okay, plus 1 by 3 factorial into u plus 1 by 4 factorial, okay, and up to infinity. And you know u is equal to, I have already put u is equal to z minus 1. So from this we'll get the first term e by z minus 1 whole to the power 3, then the second term we'll get e by z minus 1 whole squared. After that we'll get e by 2 into z minus 1, okay, and up to infinity. So there are, you know, infinite number of terms, and from this we'll get only 3 terms in negative power of z minus 1. Hence z is equal to 1 is a pole of order 3. Okay, we will stop here. Thank you.